All right, we're going to go ahead and start this session. So this is a big space, I realize, and people are a little spread out. The other request that we've had that will help with using this big space, but also for the people who are either watching remotely or are going to watch this on recording, is that we have to use the mics. So when you ask a question, I know it's going to seem a little clunky since it's a breakout session to use the mics, but that will help them in terms of having a recording that captures everything. So we'll try to do our best to run around with a mic if people have questions. But please don't let that hold you back from asking questions, because we're really hoping to have this be as much of a discussion as, in fact, probably more of a discussion than just a straight presentation. So I think what we wanted to accomplish today was to kind of give you an overview of how you might incorporate evaluation into the work that you do in your REU. And we're going to show a bunch of ideas at the end of things that you might consider evaluating. But in order to set that piece up, we wanted to kind of give you a framework or a way that you could make decisions about what it is that you're going to evaluate. So one of our assumptions was that some of the people here would be relatively new to evaluation. And when we go through some of those examples at the end, you're going to see things that look really good. But the reality is you can't possibly evaluate and implement all of them. You're going to have to be judicious about the items that you choose to evaluate for a couple of reasons. One, you can very easily wear out your REU students by giving them death by evaluation, where it goes on and on and on forever. Two, you're going to generate a lot of data for yourself. And so while you want to be careful, you're going to have a shot to collect data. So you want to get the data that you need. But if you get way too much data, you've now given yourself a ton of data that you're not going to use. So your students have put work into providing you with answers that you either just barely look at or don't look at all. So you want to be careful about getting that balance. So one of the ways to achieve that balance is by providing some organization or design to the evaluation that you put together. And a tool that's commonly used is a logic model. So how many people have a logic model already for their REUs? Okay. So a logic model is a visual description for what a project does and what changes it's hoping to accomplish. So when you finish creating a logic model, it should be a one-page description of your entire project that somebody could look at and they could sort of understand what it is you're doing and the changes that you're hoping to generate at the end. I've given you a couple of examples where you can learn more. There's some really good readings and templates that on the University of Wisconsin Cooperative Extension. They've got some nice resources. And there's a nice webinar and some templates at this group called evalu-8.org. And they're an NSF-funded facility to support evaluation within a wide variety of products and programs. They have a pretty nice list of webinars that you can go to learn basics, like designing your logic model. But you can also then learn more advanced things like what's the benefit of using a retrospective pretest, and how do you implement that. So there are everything from methods to broad sort of structures that you can use. So I'd highly suggest looking at their website. So here's what a logic model looks like. It's these boxes across the middle. And really, you're just laying out what you're going to do. So the first box on the far left are your inputs. And these are new and existing resources that you're going to use to accomplish a project. So things like your funding go in here. Things like the faculty who participate as mentors in your program go in here. You might have some industry partners, depending on how your REU is set up, that go in there. They may contribute money. You may also get in-kind contributions from other programs or departments on campus that can help support your REU. So next to the inputs, you're going to list the things that you will actually do. What are those main things? And those could be developing curriculum in some cases, conducting workshops that you're going to run, providing a research experience, obviously. Maybe you'll have some field trips a part of that. Maybe you're going to have some cohort building elements. But you're really going to list those items out in the activities column. In the next column over, these are your outputs. these are going to be products that are created, typically things that can be observed or will continue to exist after the project ends. So they might be presentations, for example, or a webinar that will exist at the end. They might be things like a training session that you've run. That's a single shot. You have this training material that's now put together at the end. And then those outputs are going to then generate outcomes. And so this is one place where evaluation can get a little fuzzy for some people, is terminology like outputs and outcomes and objectives. And it gets really messy because evaluators will sometimes use them interchangeably. But don't get too frightened by it. So products go into the output column. Outcomes are things that you hope to generate change. And so what will happen as a result of what you've done? These are typically going to be changes in, these are going to be impact things, so changes in things like behavior, knowledge, skills, attitudes, those sorts of things. So short-term outcomes will be things like students gain technical skills. They'll become more proficient in coding in MATLAB. Or you might change their interest in some subfield of astronomy. You're going to have longer term outcomes, midterm outcomes. Next, students will persist in their programs. Faculty improve instruction. Those are going to be something that can happen sort of in a middle time frame. And then a long-term outcome, these are going to be things like maybe you have a goal where you want to increase the diversity in the geoscience workforce. So these are going to be things that are going to be the big sort of changes that you want to make in the system as a whole. And this shows how your program maps into that. So I'll work you through one simple example that I've put together here. So on the far left, I have inputs, and this is from MyRU. So we've got some time in MyRU award to work on this particular project. So I'm showing you one element of my project. The activities, we're going to develop promotional materials. We're going to promote our RU site online and from booths at places like SACNIS, GSA, NABG, and others could be listed there. We do it at AGU, but this was what I put together quickly this morning. And we also run a minority recruitment lecture series where we send alumni from our internship program out to physics departments to give talks to recruit students to come to our RU program. So what is produced? Well, we're going to produce advertising flyers, a web page, some materials like that. We're also going to be producing personal contacts and contact lists that we can then follow up with. And we're going to produce some talks, so the actual speakers visiting the HBCUs and the HSIs. Those are the outputs, the things that we're producing. So what are my outcomes? Well, my outcomes start on the with annually, EPO staff will recruit an intern application pool that contains at least 15% racial and ethnic minority. For some of you, that sounds horribly small, but if you are familiar with the seismology community, we're very male and we're very white. So that's actually a bit of an improvement. Actually, we bumped that number up a little bit. The midterm outcomes, so what do I want to happen next, sort of in a longer term, that annually, and we could actually do this, I actually use this more as an aggregate, so over a certain year average, so over a three-year average, EPO staff will ensure that the population of interns accepted into the internship program is more diverse than the population of geoscience faculty. And then my long-term outcome is within 15 years, the diversity of the geophysics community will increase by at least 10%. So I hope that shows how we can go from an activity that we want to do to products we might produce to then outcomes that we can actually measure and collect some data on, and then long-term outcomes that would be changes in the whole system. Now, we might not be able to attribute all of those changes back to my RAU, but I certainly would never try to make that claim that I'm the only reason that the geophysics community changed its demographics. So I know that we're going to put these on the Google Drive so that people can create their own. This is a simple template. You can actually move all those boxes around and type in them. So if you want to make your own logic model, you can use this PowerPoint slide to actually work in that PowerPoint slide. I'd note for some of you that want to get a little more serious with this, I use a tool called OmniGraffle. It's just a graphics tool that allows you to create boxes and link them together. It's really easy to use, and I'd recommend it as a place to work in. So, questions on logic models at this point?
When I think of an REU program, I start thinking of posters and talks and those sorts of outcomes that we're having the students do, and I don't see that stuff in here. Sort of, how are you thinking about that, and would you do a separate one for sort of what you want the students to do?
Yeah, so that's a good point. So I have framed this based on, this is one sort of row driven by the outcome that I have. So you might have an outcome that's further down that 90% of your participants will give a talk at a professional conference. So that might, each year. So that might be your outcome. You would have a row below this that would include that outcome, and then you would map back out, okay, what are the activities that you're going to do that would contribute to that? What are the outputs that happen along the way? And those might be things like we run an abstract writing session partway through, and then the output is the abstract that they actually submit to AGU or GSA. And so you would just have a separate row for each one of those outcomes. I tried to simplify it here by only showing just one example. Okay, so the other thing that I'll just briefly mention is that I tried to use examples of my outcomes here that are what we'd call SMART. Right? So a lot of you have objectives probably written in your project plans. Some of them may be SMART, and some of them may not be. And the problem with an objective or an outcome that is not SMART is that it's really difficult to evaluate it, because you're not making any claim about what you're going to actually change. So a SMART objective is one that's specific about what you're going to achieve. It's measurable, so you can focus on how much or to what degree. It's achievable, so you want it to be something that isn't so idealistic that you'll never ever reach it, but you want it to be something that was going to cause your program to stretch. And I wouldn't get too hung up on this one. I've written, you know, a renewal for my REU, and I've changed my outcomes and said, look, this just wasn't achievable. We weren't even getting close. But here's a real, more realistic one. Here are some new things that we're trying to achieve that. So don't get too hung up on it being set in stone. It needs to be realistic, and it needs to be time specific. So you have to have some time frame that it's going to actually occur in. Oops. So you want to think about what will you do. You want to think about who you're going to do it with and when it's going to happen. And then what do you expect as your impact at the end? What's going to change as a result of it? And so again, we can think about this, an example from my REU, which is a distributed REU. So the students are not in one place together. They're remotely placed all over the country, and we interact through a variety of cyber infrastructure. So we're going to use online tools to deliver content and facilitate connections among the students. Who are we going to do this with? Well, the interns in my program, and I should have added the mentors there. When? Well, this will happen annually. And what do I expect? Well, I expect that at least 80% of the interns each year will agree or demonstrate that they were connected to the other interns in some sort of a beneficial way. And so when I put that all together, I have a statement written at the bottom that sort of summarizes all those chunks into what we'd consider to be one SMART objective, something that's specific, time-bound, achievable, and all the other elements there. If you want to try to, if you haven't done a lot of these, there's a tool that you can use online that you can, you know, plug in who will do the work, how is it measurable, achievable, and realistic, what action, you know, what's the unit of measurement, what will be measured from X to Y. In this case, I was just filling in an example. Jim Bob in the truck is going to move stumps out of the yard, and he's going to change them from one that's in there to none. And so it'll then give you a SMART objective at the bottom. Personally, I find this tool a little constraining because you're limited to the actions and the units of measurements in the dropdowns, but it's a good place to start to kind of get a feel for how you can frame SMART objectives. But these, both of these tools, SMART objectives and logic models, will set up what items you choose to measure and what tools you want to use to actually go about collecting that data. So if you haven't gone through this process, I'd strongly recommend starting to sit down and practice with it. And then if you have questions, you can email lots of people in the community, can give you feedback on a logic model or SMART objectives, or give you suggestions on how to get going with it. So any questions on SMART objectives before we kind of step on to a few other examples?
Okay, a lot of you might recognize this. This is a consent form. So we're talking a little bit about IRB, institutional review, if you do human subjects research. And if you want to report on any of your data, you will have to go through the IRB process. And we want to put this out there. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with it, but I'm a natural scientist. By training, I came in and I had no idea what this IRB was. And it really is kind of a daunting process initially, but it's not that bad. And most institutions actually have an IRB office. They are very helpful at University of Colorado. They have people that really, they provide a lot of guidance, they provide templates, and this is a template for a consent form. So what you will have to do, and I recommend you do that, you know, well ahead of your students arriving, is that you put together a protocol, and there it's usually guided, it varies by institution, but you have to describe what you're gonna do, who you're gonna do it with, how many students, for how long, how much time, and it's actually an interesting process to go through because you have to be very specific. What do I wanna do? You have to really have your evaluation or a research plan mapped out. So there's a lot of people in the community that have gone through the process. If you're new to this and it's daunting, just send an email out on the listserv. We are all more than willing to help or share consent forms. This is just to show this was the template that we have to work from and in Colorado, but they are, I think they are mostly standardized across the country. So you will have to have all your students sign a consent form. Another thing that you should really do, it's not for the IRB process, but it's for you being able to use photos of your students, you should have them all sign a media release form, and you did this for this workshop here, but make sure you have your students do that too. And the other thing, don't just think about your students, also think about your mentors. We also collect a lot of data from our mentors, and you're not allowed to use that data, especially if you want to write publications, if you have to have the mentors also sign a consent form. You can put them online mostly. There's like different clauses in there in the protocol. You have to go, you know, it's a slightly different format. It's pretty simple. You can have the students. If you do, for example, we do pre-REU interviews, so we don't even see the students beforehand. Either you send them a package where they sign everything beforehand, or we actually have them sign an online consent form before they come and join our program. Are there any questions about IRB?
I have a question. If you're not planning to publish your data, you're just using it for tracking for your NSF report, you don't need this necessarily, do you?
You don't. If you don't publish it, at least that's the stance you might want to check with your institution. Evaluate only pure evaluation that you're not going to publish. Our IRB office doesn't want to see that. So if it's just formative, if you're just trying to improve your program, but you know, you might at some point, you start out now and things are going well, and maybe you want to write a paper at some point. So it's not, it takes a little bit of time, but then you're, you can use your data.
Can you go back and get an IRB for things that have happened in the past that you may want to include in an evaluation publication?
So you have to talk to your IRB office, and they may walk you through the process, and you can do that. For example, in the first year, we had the pre-interview, and we didn't think about having to have the IRB before the students came, and then they did the IRB, and our office said, you know, we had to ask the student, are you okay for us to use the data that we already collected? And it's a little clunky process, but it's possible. I've never done it going back to cohorts that you are not really in touch anymore with, but it's definitely possible.
I was just going to comment that Lena had asked us to, as part of receiving our grant, that we needed to get an IRB, but you have to go through the process. But in a lot of these cases, what the committee comes back and says is that you actually don't need one. So a lot of times, you put in your stuff and they'll say, okay, you're good to go.
I just want to clarify the language. The IRB board may deem your plan exempt from human subjects rule. I don't remember the actual regulation, but that doesn't mean that you don't need it. You need to be told that it's exempt from a higher level scrutiny. And just to clarify, it's based on practice at NSF. In the Division of Earth Sciences, I require the IRB upfront because I do encourage the PIs to share the results and publish the results of their REU.
And one of the things that we also didn't think about when we wrote our protocol was that we wanted to track our students. You know, we were very focused. We had our plan for the summer, and it was all lined out. And then we wanted to track the students. So one thing you can do later is you can amend your IRB. So you're going to submit your surveys, and they're going to be, you know, if you're all scrambling, you're getting it together, they have to be, they can be drafts. But then later, you go back and say, and amendments are pretty quick. You just say, well, we're actually using these questions. So you can go back and even ask for amendments later.
I think I have a question. I don't know, like when you're talking about IRB and then you're talking about the evaluation. So I think my question is like, do you intend to cover the same kind of topic or just different thing, you know, like, because actually just now when you talk about the, you know, evaluation, the logic models, and I was thinking, oh, you are talking about IRB. So, or, you know, I mean, like, do I understand it correctly, or you actually try to, you know, emphasize something different from IRB?
Do you want to answer this?
Yeah, I'll try to answer this. So, you don't have to have a logic model to submit your IRB. So, your IRB is going to be submitting the actual survey or the interview questions. And they're looking for the safety of the subjects, the students in this case, and the mentors in this case, that you'll be working and collecting data with. You don't have to have a logic model in place as part of the IRB process. They're really looking at the data that you're actually collecting. But the logic model helps you decide what data you actually want to collect. So if we go back a couple slides here, and we look at this, so you might, sometimes I'll actually insert a column between after each outcome, yeah. And I'll insert a column on measure, and I'll put a box on how I'm going to measure that outcome. And so, for example, what data do I need to collect if annually I'm going to ensure that we recruit an applicant pool that has X percentage of racial and ethnic minorities and gender distribution? I have to make sure that I have that data in order to assess that outcome. And if I'm going to collect that data, I have to submit those questions to the IRB so that they can be approved.
So pretty much you can use it as a guideline.
That's right.
But you don't have to follow.
That's right. You can use this to help drive and shape what the data collection instruments look like.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. Actually, one more comment I want to provide about the IRB question, because in my program, we happen to have to work with the IRB officers on two schools. And then my suggestion is that if you have any question about your IRB, you need to check with the specific officer who's gonna give you the approval. Because in my case, I do get different answers, which turns out take a longer than I expected time. At first, I thought I could do the exam, because one of them told me, you can exam, you don't have to do the whole process again when I renew my program. But it turns out no. The other one says no, you had to do it all from the beginning. Although you certainly can use what you had used before, but you still need to go through the process. So it's always a good idea to check with the officer who will give you the final approval. So.
Yeah, I hope that clarified. And so just to, you know, to help with thinking about this, you come up with the logic model, you come up with your plan, then you write it up in a protocol where you probably go back and fill some holes. You have your draft instruments, but if you do change throughout collecting data, you always have to go back and amend. But if they are exempt, it's pretty straightforward. So just briefly also, because some of you are new to evaluation, we now want to, we hope we've given you some framework to think about evaluation and how to collect data. Now we're going to talk a little bit about what types of data you can collect. And you know, to start out with, there's obviously the difference between formative and summative evaluation. And formative evaluation is providing your program with information how to improve it. So you can ask about logistics, you can ask about mentor match, you can ask about, you know, any question that you as a program manager might want to use to make your program stronger. That's formative, that's really informing your program. And if you're only doing that, back to your question, Rafael, you don't need an IRB. You have to go through the process, especially for NSF, to say I'm only doing evaluation, and they're going to say it's you don't have to go through the process. Summative assessment is really when you want to measure your outcomes, when you want to see what's the impact on the student. It's like the thought about impact, what does my program, what are the outcomes of the program, and how do I measure those? So that is really the difference between the two. And if you want to publish about your RAU, you will certainly want to collect data on impact on your students. Any questions about the broad difference? Okay, so we now going to jump in into a few examples, and I think Michael and I, we're going to just talk about different things we do, and feel free to chime in and say in our program we actually do this. So we're hoping now to have this be just, you know, share out what is possible. So in terms of front-end examples, I've mentioned this before. In our program, we do a pre-program interview, where we ask the students about their expectations, about how, you know, where they see challenges, what they're excited about. We also ask them about their career plan, so we have a baseline. So we are collecting a lot of baseline data where we then later can say, okay, they were, you know, they've never done research before, they were not sure where they were gonna go, and now they are motivated for a PhD program, or things like that. So it's really collecting both the baseline for our summative evaluation, but it's also helping us expect what these students are going to be like. And we actually have a graduate student do this. It's not one of our program staff, to keep make this not so, just to lower the barrier of maybe sharing. The students have actually shared, you know, what they are really nervous about, and that they don't even know why they were selected and things like that. And then we address that in the first week. We also measure grit, perceived confidence, self-efficacy. You know, now we're talking about some baseline measures where we see what do they come in with. We do this really early on, and then we measure it again at the end, and that's that helps you in reporting changes that happen in your program.
How?
How? So I can speak to the grit and perceived confidence. There are validated instruments. I'm happy to share them, that the ones we use. They are, one amazing database is actually the ITEST program. The Stellar website has a website for evaluation tools, and you can go in there and they have the tools, they have descriptions, they have people report what they, how they used it, what the context was. And so they are the grit and perceived confidence. I can say I'm happy to share, and these are validated instruments. Do you want to?
Sure. So I would also add here, so this is something that I'm, so I measure self-efficacy, and I also use a validated instrument called the General Self-Efficacy Scale, and with some additions added to it, but there are, with that scale, there are instructions on how to generate additional items to add on to it. So in each one of these, this is an idea that we've decided in our programs is important and we want to measure because we're trying to make a change in those particular ones. You might have other aspects that you are really interested in measuring, and they may not be those ones. These may not be the right ones for your emphasis. So it doesn't, we're not suggesting that you have to do these. I think what's there is that you should spend, if you have a skill or a construct that you want to measure, if you look around, there's probably some validated instruments out there. And validated instruments means that the instrument measures what it claims to measure. It's been tested with large enough populations, and it's also been tested with a diverse enough population to ensure that it is measuring that idea. You can construct your own items as well, and there are some times where you will find things that, that there just is nothing out there, so that you have to ask, actually generate your own questions. But again, I'm happy to share the what I use for self-efficacy as well if people want to. And I think that if you put questions on the, out onto the list and say, hey, I'd like to try to measure how my students change in this area, who collects data on this, lots of us would be willing to share our questions. So.
And we'd also...
We'll repeat it.
Do you find that the students at the beginning of the REU?
Do you find that the students at the beginning of the REU overestimate their skill sets, such that if you compare it to, you know, yes, I am the greatest communicator on the planet, you know, at, before yep. they even start the program, and then at the end, they're putting down, yeah, I'm. Still very good.
Yeah, so that's
you don't measure growth in there.
Right, so that's a really well-known bias. And actually what you end up seeing in your data is a decline in their communication skill. Or in this case, it might be their quantitative skills, because at the end they realize, I really don't know as much as I thought I knew on this topic. So one way to get around that is use something called a retrospective pretest. And it's where at the end of the summer, you actually ask them both how they were coming in and how they are now at the end. And the idea here is that they actually now have a better understanding of what you're trying to measure, and so they're able to more accurately report both their pre-status and their post-status. And if you go to that evalu-8.org, there's a whole webinar on using the retrospective pretests idea and how to construct items, because there's a correct way to offer those on your survey, and once you see the format, you'll be able to quickly create items to use that address exactly that question.
So, would you suggest that we don't even offer these pre-tests for that reason?
I can tell you what I've done. Yep. I've stopped. I do ask them on a, I've cut, well maybe I should say I cut down on them to really specific things where I want to use it for a formative assessment to shape what I do, like in my orientation week, or I use it to, so I basically I'm using the assessment to drive my instruction. That's the only reason I ask it. I don't attempt anymore to try to incorporate it into my summative data at the end. It's not worth it.
We use one of the measures we use is the test of science literacy, TOSL. I don't know whatever that acronym stands for. And that test measures, has them plot graphs. You know, it's measuring actual skills. And there you can actually see, do they put units? Do they put, you know, things like that. So we met where we actually measure the skills. Those we definitely do still in the beginning. Is there anyone else who does anything else in as the front end evaluation?
We do something similar. It might be just a little different. We do the paper reading one, but a little bit of a twist is we do ask the students, you know, how their paper reading skills, and they all say they're the greatest, you know, at reading papers. But the other thing we do is we do an exercise where about a month beforehand, we have them meet with their mentors via Skype, and the mentor actually gives them papers. And then when they come back, when they their first week, they have to review the papers with the mentors, and we ask the mentors to then assess the paper reading skills of the students. As you might expect, they have a very different ranking, and then we do a kind of a midway review, and then you start to see the students almost like a U-shaped curve. They go from, yes, I was good, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh wait, I'm not really that good at it. And then we do the post one, and then, you know, they're back up there. And then by the end, you're seeing that the mentors and then the students are tracking each other by the end. So it's very similar, but a little bit of a twist with that starting point.
One of the things we've done is using eye tracking. So we've had the students read a scientific paper, a science paper, because it has to fit on one page, and read graphs, and ask them some guided questions. And then we compare them to experts, so we can see what's the difference between novice and experts. But I know that's like way beyond what you can do in a RU where you don't have funding to do a lot of evaluation. All right, let's go to... That was a nice segue that you track the middle. There are midway examples. You know, a lot of those are certainly formative, where you want to see where do we stand, where's the program, where do we need to improve. You know, clearly surveys is good. In our program, we do weekly logs. So we have every student log some data just to housekeeping, what they are doing, but we do put in some questions. And here we actually put in a lot of open-ended questions where we have the students describe what they learned, what their challenges were. And there is where we see a lot of this data, what we are all kind of, you know, when you hear Melissa Bird's story, that's, you know, that's where this feeling like a scientist or struggling like a scientist, where all of this comes in. So the front end for us is a lot of quantitative, and then we have the students report throughout the program, both in these weekly logs and then through blogging, talk about their experience, and we use that and take the qualitative data and code it and use it as examples to use case studies to show change in a qualitative way. Do you want to talk about the whiteboard talks?
Oh, sure. Yeah, so the whiteboard talks, this is a great example. Again, this is used for formative assessment. How do we know how the student's understanding their project? How do you know how things are going in the mentor-mentee relationship? And this is something that some of you may have heard mentioned. I think Val mentioned it yesterday in the session on communicating science. They basically go up to a whiteboard. You give them 5 minutes to give them an overview of their research so far, and they have no slide preparation. They have to draw it all on the whiteboard. And it's a chance for you to see student understanding, and you know, you may also detect some issues going on in the progress of that student, and it may sometimes be a mentor-mentee relationship issue. It may be that the mentor is, you know, you may uncover that they haven't made much progress because the mentor hasn't been around for 2 weeks. They've been at a conference, or a variety of issues. So it's a chance for you to just check in and see how things are going live. Another version of it that I do is post your central figure right now that best represents your research. It doesn't have to be a finished figure, and then write a descriptive caption to go with it. So the idea is that would become the core figure probably in their poster that they prepare later on. But it's the same idea as a whiteboard talk, just a chance to check in on how things are going.
And I know we don't do it, but I think other groups do it. I can't remember which group told me about this, but they meet with mentor and mentee and have the two of them do the whiteboard talk where, you know, the mentor is actually present, which raises the bar a little bit, makes it less, you make a little bit more high stakes, but then it really helps the communication between mentor and mentee, and the mentor all of a sudden sees, well, the student really doesn't understand the big picture, and that kind of sometimes helps new communication between the mentor and the mentee. Are there any other approaches to MIT program evaluation?
I like this midpoint assessment. I don't think we've done it in the Penn State Climate REU. All I've done, it's my first year directing, and a week or two after, I just knock on everybody's door or call them, both the mentor and the mentee, you know, how's things going? But I like this, it's a little bit more formal, and all right, whiteboard, I mean, are you doing this all online? Is this because you have a distributed REU?
Right, so for mine, I don't do the whiteboard talks because we're all distributed.
Okay.
I actually use the post your figure and describe it as a way for us to do it in a blog. And that way the faculty member can go and see the figure and read the description.
Oh, I see.
So we can do it all virtually. Yeah.
Okay.
So it's similar to the whiteboard talk, but modified to be.
So you just tell them, you know, by Thursday at 3 o'clock this week, post your single figure, and then everybody can see it, I guess.
Yep.
Is it the other students can see it as well, and the mentors can look at it, you can look at it, and then.
And we all comment on it. Then there's a threaded discussion that occurs about it. So
okay.
After they've presented it, then we have a little discussion about it.
Right, right.
And we actually do it in person. We're not distributed, and we've done it for the first time this year. And in our post-evaluation, the students said this was one of the most useful things they've done.
Okay.
And we actually didn't tell them beforehand. It was to not have anxiety. We work with two-year college students. Some of them struggle with anxiety. So they knew beforehand a little bit, but we didn't tell them weeks before that, so they would stress and come with a PowerPoint.
Okay. So when did you pop it on them?
I can't remember. Beck, do you remember? I think. Yeah.
Oh, so this is for, so your RU is a part of the source?
No, it's a Boulder-based.
Okay.
It's at the University of Colorado for community college students, but we have Beck as a consultant to do a skill training model from the source.
All right, and
workshop.
about when do you do that? This slide or whiteboard or thing. How many weeks in?
Around
the
4th of July. It's about half.
About
halfway.
Half. Just
four,
about
four
half.
To five.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Great. All right. Thank you.
Can I add a quick follow-up comment? We've used the idea of drawing the figure as a way to get them to think clearly about their proposal at the beginning as well. And we find that extremely valuable because then they're thinking about causality and what are the variables they're actually measuring. And it's a very valuable tool there, and I could see it'd be very nice to then visit that again.
That's a great idea.
Yeah. We actually do elevator speeches in the second week where we have them and we record those and send them to NSF. but we have the students because they will be walking around the NOAA building and people are like, who are you? What are you doing? You know, and so that they can pull out their elevator talk and have their 3-minute description of the project. And that really helps everyone to focus a little bit. So that's what we do early on too. Okay, end of program. Some of you might know this polar bear. It's one of the widely used instruments in undergraduate research self-assessment. It's the so-called IRSA test. It was developed, I don't know, many years ago, and there's an online version, and we provide the link to it, but it's one of these, it's a post-evaluation, but it measures gains. So a lot of the questions ask, how much did you gain in XYZ? So it's like this retrospective pretest where the students are asked, what is their gain? So that's really, it has a lot of questions, and there's an online version, but you can modify it to use...
Shrink it,
yes. And for example, it's for the two-year college, there were a number of questions we couldn't ask or we had to modify, but you really want to shorten this a little bit, but it's a validated instrument where there's existing data out there, so you can compare your results to other people's results, which is interesting when you want to write a paper. And there's obviously interviews. We do reflective surveys with a lot of open-ended questions to get at this, you know, what is the feeling about, what do students talk about, what do they say, and not just on a scale. And yeah, this is what we do for.
If I understand correctly, so I've gone in and I've reviewed a lot of the IRSA stuff, and we do something that's sort of modified from it, but I think they say that you can't use it technically if you have fewer than 10 students in your program. So, you know, like I said, we're basically doing the same thing, but I can't officially say that we're using the IRSA process, but I want to know what you think about that. And I think it's a confidentiality thing that if you have fewer than 10 students, you can tell who's who.
What's actually nice is there's they have aggregate scores, so they have I think 5 main scores that they where they compile answers to questions to how much did they gain in thinking about thinking about themselves as a scientist. There's 5 different constructs and they aggregate the responses. So what we do is we actually use these 5 constructs. They're also a lot easier to report on than the million questions in the IRSA. And if you want, I can send, there's a paper by Weston and Larson that describes this and also the challenges. But we still use it. In our first year, we had 7 students, and so we still use that.
Some of it may have to do with the reliability question and the validity of the actual items. Sometimes there's constraints on how many students have to take it in order to be able to draw certain conclusions. But it's a good example. I wouldn't shy away from it because you have fewer than 10. So the other thing that's going on is the biology REU is developing a modified version of this. So they're all going to a common evaluation tool. And some people are really excited about it, and others are a little less excited about it. There was quite a lot of conversation about this. But it's being piloted by some folks at the University of Wisconsin-Madison who are developing it. And I'd recommend that you take a look at it as well, because they've taken those items and modified it to fit what their community has decided they're interested in. And it's a slightly different version, but worth looking at as well. And I actually, can they get access to it, Lena? Do you know? Can they get into it?
It's not working.
Oh, it's not working. All right, sorry about that. That was just a tease. I saw it working at one point, but not anymore, or the pilot of it. Okay.
Can you elaborate on your tracking? Just always curious about who does what.
So I can say what we do, but what I've learned from, I actually asked that question, how others are used track on the listserv, I think, in December last year, 2015. And there was an amazing discussion about it, especially there were different sites sharing what they do. And I think it's worthwhile going to the listserv and looking at that question. What we do is we do survey. We have a longitudinal survey about 6 months in. And it's very interesting how perceptives change over 6 months. We had, and I've shared the story, we've had a student that was kind of at the end upset and said, you know, why are you doing this? Why are you putting so much money in these individual students and doing these silly projects? I think it's not a good use of taxpayers' money, is what she said at the end of the RU. And we were kind of frustrated. And then 6 months later, we did the survey. She was the first one to respond to the survey. And she said, I had no idea how much this RU changed my academic career. And you know, it's interesting to do this longitudinal survey, and I don't know, this is just a compressed version of this story, but we do a survey. Our RU has only run 3 years, including pilot now, and so we've done the survey every year, but I think we're going to stop to not over-survey. We'll try to be a little bit more selective about who we survey so they don't have to say the same old thing again. So we are in the process of figuring out how to track.
Well, yeah, it's keeping in touch with them and getting responses is the big thing. And so, I mean, there are lots of little tricks, right? Like, it's a lot better if I send them a personal email to the students and I show, you know, in that email I include pictures of myself on vacation with my kids and say, hey, here's what we did this summer. Because really, we're interested in keeping in touch with them anyway, for the most part. But I find that if I send the email rather and with a link in it for them to fill it out, that gets me a higher response rate than if I have somebody else send it or some automated system send it. You know, because it is that personal connection that's really important. The other thing that we're currently doing is building a system to pipe responses so that you don't have to, the intern doesn't have to always enter the exact same information every year. We already know, because we've been running for so long, we already know what their current employment was the last time we asked them 3 years ago. So we don't want to have to ask them again because it may not have changed. It's already in there. So anything that we can do to make it more efficient on their help on their end helps increase our response rate. So that's one of the ways we're able to get a higher response rate.
Very quickly, sitting on some of the panels for the REUs, you often the REU panels are made up half of educators and half of scientists. And the conflict in the room is fairly substantial in that the educators want a lot of money spent on external reviewers. They don't want us doing the assessments. And I view the money that goes to an external reviewer as money that could be spent on another student when it's well documented that these experiences are making a difference. So while we have to do assessments, but how much we do assessments, it becomes very frustrating for me.
And I guess that's why we started with this logic model. It's really, what do you want to know? And we've put out a lot there, and you can totally over survey your students, and not just the students, but the workload on analyzing the data and making sense of the data is large. So it's a good question, because you know everyone in the room knows that staff time is extremely limited on the regular REUs unless there are some supplemental funding. So it's a good question.
So one thing I might add there is, it is a good question, and we do have, there's lots of papers out about the skill development that students get and those sorts of things. But the goal of the evaluation is for your program to demonstrate that there's a high likelihood that you're going to get those same results. And so you can do that in a couple ways. One way is by noting from the literature base, so developing a needs assessment, so saying, okay, from the literature, here are the things that the literature says generate these outcomes. And then you want to be able to ensure or document through your evaluation that you have those elements, and you can use a sort of a therefore, right? We have these things, the literature suggests this is powerful, therefore we assume we are going to generate those claims. And if you're not interested in doing, say, research or publishing on your REU, it's a way to show that it's likely that your program is successful based on existing literature. So you being aware of that existing literature is still really important, and it's a way that you don't have to, you know, then you don't need to see how self-efficacy plays a role in the REU, you know, a research experience for a student, unless you're interested in that.
I'm curious, just to ask the group a question, how many people are using education experts at their university for doing evaluations? So it's a good number. And so you were kind of complaining about that. Is it costly? Yeah, okay. So we're spending. There's a tension there, sure.
Sorry, I'm not complaining about the assessments at all. What I'm complaining, what my concern is, can we not do it effectively in a way that's not biased for gathering the results? Because it might be cheaper if we could do it in-house in some way.
There are definitely models for that, where you might build your survey instruments with an evaluator, and then you might use those instruments that were to help you collect the data, but you might then, you know, work on data collection yourself. You might try to aggregate the results and then work with an external evaluator at the end to try to sort of bring those ideas sort of together and to have them help you write the final report, because then they're going to look at the data and they're going to say, you know, okay, you're cherry picking this data, right? You're only showing the highlights. So having the external person, it can be useful, but it doesn't mean that they have to do every single step of the process.
Thank you.
Yeah, we found it useful at our at RAU, and it, and it, and they're, I thought quite cheap, like 1 week of someone in the, it's called Teaching and Learning with Technology. It's a place at Penn State. 1 week of their time per year. I mean, that's the time I don't have to spend doing it. So I
and you might
want
to think
well
about using students too. We use a lot of student time for analysis. You have to include them in your IRB, but yeah. I just want to say that both of us, as I said earlier, we have hard deadlines. We have to leave at 11. So the session is maybe, Beck, you have one more question, and then we might have to defer to discussions.
Yeah, I was interested in whether there would be any interest in creating a complete single evaluation fits all that we could literally survey our own students. It would be aggregated at a common source. We could get results from our own REUs, but all of it together could work towards a joint understanding.
You mean that's geos-related?
Yeah, I'm just wondering whether that's something that people would be interested in.
How many people would be interested in that? If there was a tool that you could use and modify, it's pretty unanimous.
Then you could use it.
Yeah.
I mean, all of our results.
Everybody could use it, yeah.
Do you have something from Lena? Okay.
Yeah. Someone published. I mean, you guys would do the IRB. We don't have to do it then.
No.
Well. Well, if we administer the survey, we can have the IRB run at our institutions. You still have to have them sign the consent form, but you wouldn't have to do it. But we could go through the process at our institution if the data is only going to us and not to you.
Right, but that would be the difference then. That would mean at AGU or GSA or AMS, you couldn't put a poster up on how successful your program is and show the results. If you don't have an IRB, you can't publish those results.
Yeah. We could report to you.
But we can use it in our report to NSF.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. It's 11.
Sorry.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Okay, in essence of time, let's do brief report outs from the last round of sessions. So why don't we start with the key elements of running an REU.
Hi, we had a very informative session here about evaluation and logic models, and there was a great PowerPoint and lots of notes that are on the working group in the Google Drive, so I won't talk through all of that. I'll say that the main things we focused on were what to evaluate, that you can evaluate everything, so you can use a logic model as a tool to figure out the components that you really want to evaluate and how you want to do that. So there are some really good examples of logic models and how to create them, focusing on smart outcomes that are specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time-specific, and some tools for writing those as well. Then we also talked about IRB, and I'll just quote Anna saying, it's not that bad. I agree. It might be new for you, but there's lots of help for that, both in this group and just at your own institution. Don't be afraid of contacting your institutional research board early to make sure that you have everything in place before the students get there. Lots of details in the discussion about what does or does not need approval, which you can check in the notes. And then a lot more about evaluation and examples of ways to collect data at the beginning, the midpoint, and the end, and all of that tied to that logic model and achieving the outcomes that you want to achieve. And I'll stop there since we don't have a lot of time.
Thank you. Do we have a reporter from Raising Career Awareness and Developing Professional Skills? Great.
Hi. So we spent quite a bit of time talking about how all of our students can't go into academia and get a PhD and become a faculty member because there just aren't enough jobs there. So we really need to do our students a service by providing ideas and alternate career paths. And one important aspect of that, we're hoping NSF will hear a message about a lot of students want to get a master's degree and then go into industry because master's degrees are the most employable degrees. They can do more with a master's degree, but yet a lot of faculty are discouraged from taking master's students, and we are encouraged to only take PhD students. So there's sort of a disconnect there. But in terms of running your REU programs, think about educating your students on alternate career ideas, and there are a lot of resources that are detailed in the notes. But examples of some of these resources, Lena just sent out an email on federal internships. There are other resources available on the AGI career page or the SAGE to YC, which is another resource for career, alternate career ideas. And don't be afraid to invite speakers from the human resources groups from those other agencies, federal internships, for example, to come and talk to your students about career opportunities with their agencies. And then we need to develop more of the soft skills and the technical skills that you are already doing through the REU programs, but the soft skills are coming along with it. So communication skills, how do they prepare a resume, interview skills for getting that job, working with the graduate school if they're interested in applying for graduate programs. And a lot of those resources are available. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. So take advantage of those where you can find them. And there's a lot of information on the REGO workshop webpage as well for information on how to develop those soft skills for your students. I think that's it. We covered a lot, but I think that's the highlights. Thanks.
Do Do we have anyone from the ethics group that could come up and report out on your group?
So we had a small but mighty group of four. We had a nice discussion about research, so the responsible conduct of research aspect of ethics, but more broadly about the environmental ethics that isn't really a strong part of our ethics discussion these days, at least in the groups that we are running. Diana leads an RU program that focuses on Native American students. And so there was a big discussion about cultural inclusivity and how to consider cultural perspectives in the discussion of ethics, how to bring that into your RU program and start with the student's perspective on what they think of as research ethics and how that relates to what our broader communities are thinking about ethics, our communities being NSF, our institutions, our professional societies. A couple things that we put into the Google Doc are some, so you may have heard of the lab. It is something from HHS, NIH, on looking at doing basically a choose your own adventure for research ethics. That there's a link that it's a video-based link. We believe that there's some research ethics information from the last time we ran a GORE workshop, and I was looking in the old Google Docs and I couldn't find it, so we're hoping that some of that information can be made available to a lot of the new PIs and to the group as a whole, as well as the BioREU program has a bunch of information on what they have pulled together as a community for instilling and talking about research ethics within your REU program. So there was, just to wrap up, the importance of including the cultural sensitivity to what your group of students has and how that reflects in the training of ethics for your students over the course of your summer. Anything else to add to that?
And last but not least, do we have somebody from the group of publishing on your REU?
Hi, my name's Liz Cottrell. I'm at Smithsonian. And we were a group of about 15, led by Susan Sullivan. We're very grateful to her for that. And our group, we have questions. Our group wanted to know what NSF's expectation is for publishing, how many REU site PIs are publishing, and then how and where to publish and strategies for success in publishing. And I had this feeling, I came to the meeting with this feeling that publishing was in the solicitation, and I was very insistent that that was so, and it's not. And my information, I confirmed with Lena and made sure my quote was okay before I got up here, is that in calling my program officer about my renewal, my second implementation, what would that look like? What would a second renewal look like? And she said, well, in your renewal, are going to want to know that you're, how are you sharing your information? We want you to publish. We want you to share. If you're, you know, the panel, I guess, is driving this, saying, okay, this is amazing. How are you going to let the rest of the community know? How are we going to disperse best practices? And so I'm getting it from my program officer, not from the solicitation. We talked about the challenges of publishing, small amounts of data, not enough funding from NSF to do the publishing part or the evaluation part. Needing to become grounded in a literature that's not your own literature, it's the education literature perhaps, instead of your discipline-specific literature. The lack of a control group, although we decided that might be a false dichotomy that came up. And this idea of publishing can't be that you want to share your great thing, that this is neither useful nor interesting to others, and it's not actionable. So how do you turn your great thing into useful, actionable information? We talked in Solutions and Strategies, Journal of Jesus Science Education. This was shocked me, but that you can expect 3 to 4 rounds of revision on your paper, and that Journal of Geoscience Education looks at the publishing process as an educational mission of the journal itself. So not to be daunted by all those reviews and revisions. And the idea is needing to situate your claim about how great your thing is within a theory of change or some other conceptual framework. And we talked about other places to publish beyond Journal of Geoscience Education. In terms of resources, we had some names. This is all in the Google Docs, so you can look at those. But one thing that I thought was interesting that we learned is that Journal of Geoscience Education, if you have been met with rejection there, they actually have several paper tracks. A research paper, which is more about the theory, pushing the bounds of theory, versus curriculum and instruction direction, which is more of the practical practicalities of implementation. And in terms of ideas for collaboration, we talked about the power of the people in this room to create control groups for each other. So if I'm doing something in my REU and I need a control group, maybe you're not doing that in your REU, and your REU students can become my control group for my study that I want to publish. And so maybe if we all help each other out, we will all have control groups. And so maybe during the panel time, NSF can speak to this further if NSF program officers in the room know how many REU site PIs are publishing and what is the expectation, and also what does NSF want to know? What would be useful to NSF in terms of what we publish?
So before we start our last exercise, I want to take a little bit liberty to thank the organizers for this conference. Val Sloan is amazing, and not only for her ability to herd cats, but she has single-handedly, well, with her staff and colleagues, has single-handedly helped us unify as a group of professionals with a common goal. So through the listserv. Other people who helped with this meeting, Allison Smith, Megan Jennings, and Melanie, who I don't have a last name for. But yeah, so thank you again for your hard work and amazing dedication to our group. So do you want to start the panel? Go ahead.
I actually want to thank Val one more time also, because you do put a ton of effort into all of this, and it happens seamlessly in the background, and it's great. I mean, you need somebody that just takes the charge and does the organization. So next, there's going to be a panel meeting that's going to answer some questions about how we use these reviews that we get back from our students, either midterm or in the final evaluations, to reshape our REUs. And so sitting on that panel is going to be Carla, Mike, Daphne, and Charles. And I guess this is going to be a short thing, shortened thing.
and using this experience to help them learn more about what they could do after this experience was over and within their field. So at every point along the way, we assess students constantly for what would they like to see within our program, how effective is the program, how are they feeling it's a successful approach, whether their research is going well or whether the cohort building is what is most important to them. So with that, I'll pass it on.
We, much like Carla, we also have a evaluation throughout the course of our program. We do pre-evaluation and post-evaluation, and we've been doing this for over a decade or more. One of the ways that we've used this evaluation is to change how we run our ethics program over time. Years ago, over a decade ago, the ethics program at Maryland Sea Grant kind of was the one-off lecture on what is research ethics. And through our interactions with our students and our evaluation process, we've evolved that over time into a kind of introductory, how do you get to know research ethics? We have students that are responsible for going online to do this, the lab that I mentioned to you. We do case studies as part of a workshop, and we get our faculty together with our students to talk about experiences that they have had as researchers and how those experiences, those ethical dilemmas that they've faced are gray, and the students can relate to those. And so we continue to evolve based on this feedback that we're getting, and we're going to evolve it in the future, in the next year or two, as we're thinking about these things getting stale, our faculty doing the same thing year after year and not wanting to do it in the same way anymore. So how can we change that to make it more effective for our students and make our faculty still want to be engaged in sharing their stories and being effective mentors to our students?
Turn it off.
Okay.
How about that? Can you hear me? Okay. Got it.
So, in a short thing, yes. I think the most important thing that you can do is be mentally engaged in your program. Beyond any other I you dot or T you cross, if you're mentally engaged in your program, you're going to be doing this. Because you're listening to your students all the time. You're looking at the feedback that you get on your pre-post and your formative evaluation, whatever you're doing, and you're constantly thinking about your own experiences, thinking about any literature you might have read, watching what's happening in the program, and trying to solve problems. So the confidence continuum poster that I have over there, number 19, it was a combination of all those things, solving a problem, thinking about the nature of research, conversations I want to have with my students that might not be clear, helping them because we want to help them find career direction, and so on. So I probably have lots of examples, but that's one that a lot of you are aware of already, that it's just a confluence of all these things and being mentally engaged in what's happening.
Thanks. So I focused my thing on the structures that make it possible for us to improve. What you say is completely true, and we try to do that all the time. But what is it about our programs that actually makes it work? We've been doing this now for 14 years. We have 16 years of total funding, and hopefully many more, depending on the kindness of everyone who reviews and so forth. But to honor Val's request for Prince, I have some lyrics for you all, and I'll try to perform them. So, as we all know, we remember better with music sometimes than with other things. So think about Prince from Purple Rain. Did, if you will, a picture of Earth and space engaged in a kiss. AM and H and Q need together. Program officers, can you picture this? Okay. So, Those three elements that I put there are really the thing that helps us. First of all, we're a collaboration between Earth and planetary sciences and astrophysics. So we have two separate cultures that we're learning from all the time. We don't get stale because we're always combining. Second, we are a collaboration between the American Museum of Natural History, where the students gather for most of the summers, and the City University of New York, which has more than a dozen faculty members who are research associates of the museum. We designed this many years ago. I was full-time at the museum, and then I took a faculty position in the CUNY system, and we tried to make sure that everybody would still retain those connections. So we have this vibrant information, people coming together. And finally, we've talked to every single program officer that we've been working with all these years, all the time. We really trust their judgment. We really get a lot of help from them, and we're always interacting back and forth. It is that synergy between all these different parts of our structure that makes it possible for us to succeed.
So one thing I'd like to add is the first REU award that you get, you're trying out a lot of things. You're trying new things, you're struggling, things may not work. By the time you get to the second round of application, you should be eager and willing to go into the literature. There's such rich literature for founding whatever you propose to do on measurable objectives, new partnerships, new ideas, maybe a little bit of risk. But for those of you who have been running REUs for a really long time, maybe it's time to not do the same old, but think of these new ways that you can set up programs that are very rigorous and still very fun for the students.
Absolutely true. We would not have survived this long if we kept doing the same thing all the time. And at the same time, recognizing, you know, for us, for AST, what do they as a community want in a good REU program, and then YAR, what do they want in a good program, and we together make it happen, changing all the time, evolving all the time.
I wonder if you guys survey your mentors and ask them if there are programs or workshops that they wish you guys were doing for your students in general, and if you can give us examples of those.
Absolutely. And then we try to tackle the how do we deal with the different skill sets of the students coming in, so we don't necessarily require that the students go to the workshop. A statistics workshop came up from mentors. A programming workshop came up from mentors and students. Those are a couple examples. But yes, absolutely. The mentors are a great source of information for you, another perspective and ideas. So one year when the Day After Tomorrow movie came out, someone came to my office and he was all excited. He and another scientist were talking when they were jogging at lunchtime, and they had this great idea for me. And if you're open to those things, that also, like, I was like, well, what is it, you know? And then we call over to grant some contracts. You're like, can we do this? Can we buy movie tickets? We're gonna do a panel the next day with Joe Friday and other people, climate scientists, and it'll be awesome. And they said, well, as long as you've got the educational piece and the way you wrote your activity line, you have a little bit of wiggle room in there, sure, you can do it. You know, so I love getting the ideas from other people as well and not having them to all be mine. I'm glad they don't have to be.
You know, we survey our mentors at the end of the program, but we also have like the mentors as part of our selection committee. And so we, every year, talk to the mentors about what works, what doesn't work, and what can we do to make it more effective for you guys. Inevitably, maybe this is true for all of you, it's true for us, our mentors want more time with the students to do research and less of our professional development. And they don't all fully grasp the importance of the experience part. So it's a constant education piece with our mentors to get them to understand that these broader things that we talk about as a community are very important to the whole. Go ahead.
Yeah, my question follows up directly on what you just said, and I have to admit that Charles somewhat planted me to ask this question this morning on the bus based on something he heard me over saying in a group. It's exactly about mentors. And I run a program, 16 interns every summer. Over the lifetime of the program, we've had about 90 mentors. Okay, so this is way more than I can individually noodle with. And our program had been running for like 20 years, but had broken down, this is before I worked there, in 2009, and had been discontinued because of mass mentor revolt. That the mentors, and there was an external evaluator who came in and wrote a big report about this, the mentors quit. Too much curriculum, not enough time for research, quality of students had gone too low, such that the researchers weren't getting what they needed to get out of it, early career researchers particularly. So as an REU director of a distributed REU, my researchers, my mentors, are trusting me to deliver a high quality intern to them. And sometimes they have very specific requirements of what they want. So while I have some, like say, great mentors that really get it, get what we're trying to do, they get the whole thing, they still might really need the student to have taken anatomy, right? Which maybe you wouldn't get a community college student who's had anatomy. And so I'm interested in how you have worked with your mentors over the year, because I feel like the day, if I was the only person taking, like when I take a student, I sometimes take the high risk student, as it were, for myself, because I only have myself to trouble with it. But the day I stopped delivering high quality students and giving them plenty of time to be in the lab with their mentor is the day I lose my mentors, and then the whole program, you might as well just go home if you don't have your mentors. So how do you, like exactly what you said about educating your mentors, is that it? You just keep preaching the gospel and they...
So those difficult situations that we talked about the other day, I didn't bring this up because it's kind of mundane in the scheme of things that we talked about in that session. But I had a student who was in tears. Week three, I just don't understand what I'm doing. My mentor doesn't spend any time with me. It was a new mentor. So I went to his office and I said, I am so sorry I haven't had a chance to sit down with you yet and talk to you about REU. And then I just waxed poetic about all the great things about REU and the things from the solicitation about how we're supposed to, we're the big research university. So what we're supposed to do is bring all the students in from teaching colleges and things like that. And I didn't talk about his student at all. I just was like all rah-rah about REU and what the whole point is. He flipped on a dime, was an awesome mentor, and never volunteered again. But hey, you know, they self-select out, that's fine. Because, and luckily, I have a deep enough pool of mentors that that works all right. Otherwise, the other thing you said is, I talked to the mentors about how a few of you can specify something more advanced, but I can't have all of you do that because I can't meet my goals. And so it seems to work out most of the time, even though we're not distributed, but we are in a building that holds 400 people, so we're not, you know, it might not be as hard as you as for you but to get them kind of on the same page.
Part of what I do is hold an annual, before the program starts, mentor orientation type event.
Yeah, we do that. It's a great thing.
Bring them together, remind them again what the REU is all about, what we're looking to accomplish, and so that they at least try to start on the same page. Something I did this year, surely by accident, was I had was making an offer to a student. In our program, I make all the offers and loop the mentors in, and that's how it's always been done, and it works effectively. This time I had, because I didn't understand the mentor's research very well, and I really wanted the student to understand what was going on. So I had the mentor and the student on the call at the same time when I made this offer, and I waxed poetic about what the REU program does. And afterwards, this new mentor said, I had no idea. I never could have talked about what the program was all about. I'm so glad I was on that call with you so that I have a better understanding of what we should be doing this summer. And so looking forward, that may be something that I do more often with, particularly with new mentors who are not familiar with how the program, what the depth of the program is supposed to be.
If we finish in 6 minutes, we will be right on time. So we have about, let's finish in 6 minutes, but please go ahead.
The only comment I'd have is we had to come up with some pretty innovative partnerships because we had the faculty who were like, this is not effective use of my time to advance my research goals. So what we did is we went to the university, we found out various mechanisms that graduate students get summer support. We partnered with those organizations, and now priority is given to labs with graduate students where the graduate student will commit to to being a near peer mentor on the island full time. And so by doing that, that takes a little bit of pressure off the primary mentor who comes out frequently but isn't there all the time. And it also helps us be able to train graduate schools in how you mentor graduate students in how you mentor. But that financial partnership where we went and we said, all right, you've got a whole bunch of graduate students applying. Can we tell you which labs have expressed interest in hosting an REU for the summer, and can they be prioritized for summer funding? And that's been a huge help for us. Every year it's pretty stressful getting mentors on board.
Yeah, I talk to mentors about having a co-mentor. So I also look at their own experiences and send advice to the new ones. So you might want to consider having a co-mentor, because well, if you have a trip this summer, that'll help out a lot. Or you might want to have a co-mentor who helps with the programming part of it or whatnot. And then that gives them sort of ideas and permission and thoughts about that. And more recently, we've had graduate students involved. We, for a while there, the chair of our School of Meteorology was a little bit like, don't take away from their research in the summer, because that's when they get all their research done. But that attitude has changed, and the graduate students who've been involved have loved it, and they've talked about all that they gained from being in that mentor role. It put them in a different mindset. They learned a lot from that experience, and then I carry that forward now to when I'm soliciting for mentors.
Yeah, Yichung Chung, Oregon State University. I'm really curious to see if there's a possibility. This is an idea that a couple of us have kind of kicked around, which is we do a lot of evaluation on our students and the impact of our programs on students. We really need to do a study to look at the impact of this program on our faculty. It'd be interesting to start, especially with this group, to develop a knowledge base, a publication base around impacts of this program that support faculty to possibly get more funding, additional funding for their research, the broader impacts, somehow figuring out how to tie that into the P&T process, and to really show our faculty and our faculty mentors that, hey, we've had this mentor do this for 10 years, and we can associate these grants, because we know that some of our faculty use these REU positions to try out really innovative new areas of research. And as a result, if it's successful, those faculty actually get additional, like major grants to do research in that direction. There's a way for us to be able to get that information, start developing a publication body of knowledge to support P&T process for our faculty. That may change the way some of our faculty look at this program, these internship programs, mentoring. And it's a long process. It's not going to happen overnight. But it's definitely something that I'm kind of interested in pursuing.
So should we like all send you emails and say, yeah, let's do this?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
And can we include the impact on that the benefit of mentoring on postdocs if you involve postdocs in your mentoring? Because I pitched to postdocs that this is a benefit to them when they're writing those teaching statements in their job application.
Yeah. For many, since we do have many museum people involved who have never taught before, being able to put the fact that you put students down and you successfully enabled them to become good scientists have helped them. But we have not done anything quantitative. We were able to say qualitative things that our mentors, especially those who are not tenured, are very happy and very glad that they did this thing in order to help them develop professionally as well. But quantitative stuff would be very helpful. I agree. If there is not one more comment, then we're done, because it's 11:44. We got one more comment. Okay, here we go. David?
I would actually say the same thing.
Okay.
Although
I do have a comment. For the mentors, so we're from a research institution that has no educational mandate. And so for my mentors, they love the fact that they get an undergraduate student in their lab to do the work. It also helps with participant support and that kind of aspect. And then I also sell it, you know, I'm an organismal biologist or a physiologist, and I use my REUs to link me with some of the gene jockeys that we have on our campus, and it helps bridge kind of our research in ways that otherwise I wouldn't have time or the resources to do. And so they're really great ways to sell this kind of experience to your mentors.
I noticed that people, scientist mentors, would try it. They would dust off a little thing on the bookshelf project and try it out. And the next thing you know, it's on the cover of National Geographic through. And you're like, that's because you're our RU student. You know, and they're like, who? You know, they don't necessarily kind of make those connections. Some probably do. I think the publications might be another thing to look at as well of the students and the faculty in that kind of capacity. And also the networking. This is something I found, at least when I was running Recess, was I would look for a mentor, let's say, at the U.S. Geological Survey. And somehow they would say, well, it'd be great if I could use that LIDAR instrument at UNAVCO, you know, and then you'd end up with people from scientists from UNAVCO working with the USGS scientists, and maybe then a CU Boulder scientist, and then they start talking to each other and collaborating, and I don't know how you measure that, but Yichang, maybe that would be another piece to add, would be like the network map of mentors, that how that's impacted by the REU.
Okay, we're done, right on time. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, panelists. And Charles, we'll forever remember you for your Prince songs. Okay, before we do the talk sort of in a wrap-up way, I want to mention just two things. One is the Google documents are going to be open and up for indefinitely. You can add to it. If you want to add links or upload files, please do. And we'll be going through it and trying to organize that information and make it, you know, easy to use. There will be a survey. There is a survey that's going to be automatically emailed to you. It comes from my email address through SurveyMonkey, and it's set to go off at noon today. If you're going on the field trip, though, wait until after that. Thank you all for being so engaged and providing ideas and strategies and being open and being respectful and really honoring some of the themes that have been difficult and also are beloved and close to our hearts about inclusivity. It feels like it's always great to see people face to face, so that, you know, when you go forward, you remember that person when you're emailing and so on. I guess in terms of looking forward, we probably will be hosting another one of these in about 2 years. We hope, we're talking about the idea of having it be next to or in the same place and relatively the same time as one of these conferences of one of the minority science organizations. So it would be, you know, one of the ones that we heard about. And those are generally in the fall. We can figure out the timing. The timing of the part of the week will depend on that conference. So there are other factors that determine, like, the time of the semester and the time of the week. And I realize that weekdays are not as ideal for professors who are teaching, and early in the first month is not good, that kind of thing. But we'll hope to have a lot of notice so that you can plan accordingly. And we'll also look for some input on that. So just to open up the floor before we wrap up, would anybody like to talk about looking forward? I mean, we've had some great ideas of projects looking forward, looking at the overlapping of applications and how to, with Michael's project, Yichang's initiating a project. Where are you, Yichang? Are you in here? Yeah, you can see if NSF's interested in, you know, there might be some money to help you do a study like that on the impact of the mentors of REUs, for instance. I don't know, who knows? But would anybody like to just talk about, you know, where we're going or make any last comments about before we disperse into our various directions?
Is there any intended cycle of meetings for the future? I mean,
About every other year. Yeah. I need somebody to come and synthesize everything beautifully. Okay, go for the mic.
Yeah, Val, let me just ask you if you'd be willing. In April of this past year, there was a so-called Pan-REU conference that was held. About 80 REU site directors across all the divisions and the directorates came together, met in DC for a couple of days, and had very similar conversations to this. Is your sense of what was discussed there relevant specifically for our group here? Any one or two really good nuggets that you feel like we should all know about thinking going forward?
So we were there, a few of us were there at that meeting, and in designing the agenda for this workshop, in addition to looking at the survey that you guys filled out beforehand, looking at the past agenda, I also looked at the final report and the agenda of that meeting and included some of those things into this agenda or put higher priority on them. For example, like having breakout sessions on recruiting students and supporting students from community college students as a separate section, you know, things like that. I don't know, I'm trying to think. It was pretty clear that you know, that the issues were really common across the disciplines. That was interesting to me to hear, like when the NSF officers gave talks, it really brought everybody together because we could hear that we're all having a lot of similar issues. It was also clear to me that I thought like that our division does a really nice job of the people who run these programs really, as you say, get it, you know? I mean, I sat next to a math REU PI, and at the first dinner, the question was asked at the dinner to share with your neighbors at the table, how do you welcome students to your REU? And how do you make them feel like they belong? This guy said to me, why would I want to do that? He literally did. Yeah, he said, if they're in, they're in. I'm not kidding, this is what he said. If they're in, they're in. They belong. And I said, well, have you ever felt like you joined a group or came somewhere and you didn't really know that you belonged? No. Well, I don't know, so okay. Anyway, so we talked and it was really interesting. It was so interesting. It was, you know, kind of shocking and fascinating and like a sociological study. So, you know, but it was also really inspiring to hear, you know, other people's ideas. You were there, right, Charles? You were, and that's right, you were doing Purple Rain there. So what about you? Did you have any nuggets you wanted to, that you came away with?
Well, the overriding feeling that I had at that event was that every kind of REU, every division had its own unique personality. And it was so interesting to learn different things, whether it was from math, geo, astro, social sciences. The economists had fascinating ideas. Biologists, chemists, everybody seemed to have a different thing. And so if there is something to be learned in general by having all of us meet together is not only to have the commonalities, but also to talk to other people in other divisions and learn from them their cultures and how they work. And we can learn from them certain things. In astronomy, for example, we have no common instrument of evaluation, whereas in other fields, every single REU hands out to every single one of its students a single online evaluation form. They get great data for engineering, for example, I think was remarkable. So learning across the disciplines, I think, would be valuable. If you have another institution, or if your institution has another REU from another site, another department, talk to them. We'll learn something really cool from them, whether it's something shocking or something amazing, or both.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It seemed like at that meeting they discussed a lot of the long-term tracking, which were common, the common app, and there was a third one. And evaluations, right, the common assessments. And those were things that went across kind of all the disciplines. There were some great stories there, too. There was one math PI that I met who was ADD, and he ran a whole program only for ADD math students. Yeah, and he talked about the complications of running a program like that. And, and he discussed before they would do their meeting. So the meeting was at 9 o'clock. So at 8:30, he would start to send out these text messages to all of his students that it's going to be in a half an hour. And then he'd have to do another in 10 more minutes. He'd have to send out that same thing again to get them all to show up. And invariably, there'd always be one that just didn't make it, just ended up off track and doing something different. But there were some really great stories.
They're looking for the creativity of those people.
There were some really great stories of different people and that have solved these same kind of problems, you know, that all of us have in our programs, but in unique ways.
That guy is, he said he's been getting emails from a million parents, by the way. My son has ADD, can he come to your REU? Any other thoughts before we disperse? Yeah, Lisa, did you want to take a moment?
Val, I just wanted to thank you again for organizing a fabulous meeting. Thank you for all your hard work and your staff. So
you're welcome.
You.
My pleasure.
And I wanted to thank everyone for attending. I love the energy in this room. I hope you've all had a wonderful couple of days and that you have a good time on the field trip. I'm not going to be there, but I think Lena's going to be there. And so I hope you take the energy and the ideas and move forward for the next 2 years and really make some progress with some of the things you've talked about here today. And thank you again for attending. I know it's hard to get away, but I hope you've had a good time.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, I just want to follow up with what Lisa said, and also something about at the meeting at the PAN REU that was noticeable, how great of a community we are. And we are a model that NSF is looking at on how to build an REU community and different models. So this is great. Thank you very much for all your work and for being willing to take risks of new models, because we can point out, oh no, we have a PI that is doing that. Oh no, there is a group that is looking at that. So thank you very much for letting us be so proud of you.
Yeah. I have to agree, and I felt the same at that meeting. I felt like, oh, we're kind of the best, but I don't know. I know that like bio has really, you know, there are other groups that I'm like, oh, really? You actually have me? You know, they do things with the community, and so it's also that you know, I know you and I like you, and so it makes thanks. So it's a great job, right? I have this great job. So it's just really a pleasure to work with you, and I know it's a lot of thanking, but I do want to thank you for really engaging, you know, here and 30 people presenting and 30 new people diving in, being involved in the listserv. And the listserv has 200 people, that email listserv has 200 people on it, so who are from other, you know, either past REU PIs or related or from other realms, you know, maybe kind of related overlapping realms. And so anyway, it was great to see some things pop up there last night from you guys' resources. Go ahead, Mike.
I don't know if you're going to say this or not, but there are opportunities for us to get together between now and 2 years from now at AGU, at Ocean Sciences, at SURF. There's almost always a session that we have there. Frederica Mosher and others are putting together a session for SURF. So if you're going to be going to SURF and you would like to present on URM strategies for research, please look for that abstract to put, or look for that session to put it in.
Yeah.
And often at these meetings, you can do one of these policy or education sessions and do a scientific presentation as well. So.
Right.
They're
yeah,
very
you're allowed
good
to
about
do
that.
Education and you know take you know if you want to run a session on if you're going to I'm not going personally to Oslo if you know in the future if you want to run a session on some aspect of this just put one in you know and we can help you with that.
I just wanted to also say we put in a proposal for another session at SURF for PIs to be able to talk about successful mentoring. And successes in their REUs to hopefully pass that on to other faculty and so on. So watch for that as well. It's one of the education sessions.
Right. And at many of these meetings will have an informal gathering of the REU PIs, like, you know, let's meet to go for dinner at AG or GSA. And sometimes I organize it and sometimes other people do. And it's a really nice time to, you know, continue this friendship and collaboration and to have a chance to whine about how hard it was running the REU and to have some good belly laughs and that kind of thing. So that's another piece of it. Okay, so it looks like we are right on schedule. We can break. I do want to encourage you to take a chance to look at posters some more and enjoy your lunch. If you're going on the field trip and you want to change, do that before 1 o'clock and the bus will be leaving at 1 o'clock for the field trip. Take all your belongings with you because we will not be back here. And then the bus is taking us back to the hotel after that. And others are, you're on your own in terms of your transportation, but not totally on your own because Melanie and Megan and Allison are there to help you. So have a great day and thanks so much.